With the Classic Tetris World Championships rolling around again, a lot of new players are going to want to get into the scene, just like I did a long time ago. I've decided to make this guide, which will cover many techniques and tricks to get into the NES Tetris scene, and will be almost everything you need until you get your first substantial score over 200,000 or so. This guide will cover everything from setup, terminology, the proper ways to play, and techniques that high-level players use to play. So you want to play the game, and you don't have an NES? Well, don't worry, because there are many programs that have been written to emulate old consoles, and by extension, the NES. There are three main emulators that you might want to take a look at: FCEUX, Mason, and Nestopia. There is also an emulator front-end that can give superior input lag performance compared to the rest of these, but is much harder to set up and may not work as well on lower-powered hardware, and it is called RetroArch. Nestopia is my personal favorite because you can find it on almost every platform, including Windows, Mac, Linux, Raspberry Pi, and mobile devices. And because it's a breeze to set up and load games into, I'll be using it for the rest of this tutorial, and I'll show you how to play NES Tetris through that. You can look into other options yourself if you want to. The first thing you will need is, of course, a copy of Nestopia itself. You can Google Nestopia download, or you can use the link in the description if you're lazy and don't want to look for it. After you've downloaded that, you can't play the game yet, since the emulator doesn't come with it. You'll need to acquire a copy of NES Tetris in order to play it. For legal reasons, I can't tell you exactly how, but I will give you a hint. Google is your friend. But one thing first, you're not looking for a .exe file or anything else like that. The file you're looking for has the extension .nes. The file name will look something like Tetris U in parentheses .nes, if you have the right file. If you have something that looks like Tetris E in parentheses .nes, you have the PAL version, which is very different from the NTSC version that we'll be talking about in this video. When you have both of those, unzip Nestopia and find your ROM. You can either open up the file menu once you open up Nestopia, and hit the open menu. And from here, you can select your ROM. Or you can just drag and drop it. So if you see this screen, TM and copyright 1987 Via Electron or Technica, like it just said. If you see this copyright screen, you've done it correctly. Now we need to configure our controls. So open up the options menu and select input. So here are the controls that I've already mapped. You can map your own if you hit the set all button. I'll remap these to something else. And these controls, three controls down here, Autofire B, Autofire A, and Mic, these are not important for NES Tetris, so you can just bind those wherever you want. Oh, and another thing. If you're not using a joystick or a controller, this menu over here, everything should be grayed out. If you have no joysticks plugged in, then this menu is grayed out. This would be expected. If you had a joystick plugged in, however, and it wasn't shown here, what you would do is restart the program. So now I'm going to show you how to set it up with a controller. So exact same thing as before, and now our controller is visible. So we can hit set all again and start pressing the buttons in accordance to what key we want them to be bounded to, like I'm doing right now. Again, these controls don't matter, so you can leave them unbound if you want to. And we can open up our ROM with drag and drop. While we're waiting for that to load, we can also go to view, screen size, and set it to 2x. This will make it much bigger and much easier to see. As expected, it works. If you've done everything that's shown here correctly, you should have something like this, and hitting the start button will bring up this menu. So the left button and the right button change the game type from A type to B type. The down and up arrows change the music type. Hitting start again at A type will bring you to the level select screen, where you can select any level from between 0 and 9. And one more thing from before, this is A type mode. If you go over to B type, this is a challenge mode. If you see that line counter at the top, That's our line counter for the amount of lines that we want to clear, which in this case is 25 and will always be the case without a Game Genie code. Let's go back to A-Type to show everything else. You may have just noticed that I started at level 19 there. Well, you might be like, well, you can't start at level 19. There's no selection for level 19, and you would be correct. However, the developers did include one little code so you could start at higher levels. Simply hitting start alone will only let us start at level 9. However, if we hold the A button, or whichever button you bound into the clockwise rotation, then we can start 10 levels higher than what was just selected. And just to show you that's not a fluke, let's do it again, but with level 8 instead, and start at level 18. Now you can see that this works. And if you've done everything correctly and you were able to do all those things that I just did, you can move on to chapter 2. Alright, so you have acquired an old NES with a controller and Tetris cartridge, or you may have just had them laying around. Setup for this will be much easier than emulator, so let's dig in. So here's everything that you're going to need. Your NES, your Tetris cartridge, a controller, some composite cables or an RF switch, more on these two later, and a power supply. Actually, about that power supply, even if you don't have an official Nintendo one, I don't here, one of the great things about the original NES 001 unit is that literally anything between 9 and 12 volts that will fit in the jack will work with it as long as it's above 500 milliamps or so. Polarity doesn't matter, voltage doesn't matter to an extent, and whether the output of the power supply is AC or DC, it doesn't matter. Just find something between 9 and 12 volts that will fit, and it will work. Now, time for setup. Ideally, you would still have an old CRT laying around, but most people have thrown their old ones away, so I'll show setup with a modern LCD first. But before that, a quick word on NES consoles and LCD televisions. First off, most modern LCD televisions will be very laggy with an old composite signal. This can be mitigated somewhat by putting your TV into game mode. However, no matter what you do, it will still be much worse than a CRT unless you're willing to buy a very expensive upscaler. But I don't have one, so I'm not going to talk about it. Setup on an LCD is pretty much plug and play. To hook it up to your television, you will need to connect the two RCA jacks on the side to the ones on your TV. The yellow one will need to be plugged into the yellow jack on your TV, and this one is for video. The red one can be plugged into either the white or the red one as it carries the audio. Once that is done, the rest of it works pretty much exactly as you would expect. Plug the power supply into your NES, plug your controller into your NES, push your Tetris cartridge into the slot in the front of your NES, press the power button, and select the source composite. If you see the text that starts with TM and copyright 1987 V/O Electronotechnica, you've done it correctly. A CRT works pretty much the same way, if it has composite in jacks. If it doesn't, you're going to need to use the RF port on the back of your NES. The way this works is by sending a TV signal, which is what a CRT is expecting to receive through the RF port on the back. On most TVs, this will be an F-type connection, and you can connect your NES to your TV with one RCA cable and a small adapter. However, some TVs will have two screws on them for an antenna. If you have these, your best bet is to get an RF switch box, but since it's so unlikely that you'll have a TV like this, I won't waste your time. What you need to do if you have the very common F-type jack is to screw whatever adapter you're using into the jack. In my case, I'm using an official Nintendo switch box. And your adapter should have an RCA lead on the end to plug into the white RCA jack on the back of your NES, around where you plug the power supply in. Nope, that isn't for audio, it's the signal for older TVs. Once you plug this in, you'll need to tune your TV to channel 3. If you get static after turning your NES on, tune it to channel 4. There's a switch on the back that will change the channel that it outputs on if you want to mess with that. But you should have the TM and copyright 1987 text now. If you don't, you did something wrong or you have faulty hardware. For the sake of time, I'll discuss issues some other time. Alright, you've got the game up and running using the input device of your choice. Now let's actually play it. Pressing start after 256 frames, about 4.25 seconds, from starting the game, we'll skip the copyright screen, which would normally last for 512 frames, about 8.5 seconds if not interrupted, Once you're at the menu screen that looks like this, you can hit the key you bind it to start. From here, you'll be presented with a game type selection menu and a music type selection menu. Pressing left or right will change the game type menu from A type or B type or vice versa. And pressing up and down will change the music to type 1, type 2, or type 3. So now let's talk a bit about the modes. Like I said before, A type is the endless mode that's played in competitions. B type is the challenge mode where you have to clear 25 lines at a chosen level and height. For the purposes of this tutorial, I'll be selecting A type, and that's what I'll be using for the rest of the video. You can mess with the other one on your own time if you want to. Once you have that selected, you can hit start again like I just did, and it'll bring up the level select screen along with a high score table. At first glance, it'll appear that you can select any level from 0 to 9, and you can. Like I said before though, there's a small code that some pro players use, actually all pro players, I'm sorry about that, use to start 10 levels higher. So for example, if I start level 8, if you take a look at the level counter right about here, it says level 8. But however, if we press A, or rather hold A, and then press our start button, it'll start us at level 18. So just to show you that that's not a fluke, I'll do it again with a different level, this time level 9. So I didn't hold the A button when I hit start. And if you take a look at the level, you'll see we're at level 9. However, I'm holding A and the start button, and we start at level 19. So if what I just did seems unplayably fast to you, you're not alone, don't worry. It'll take some time for your brain to start to be able to register patterns to play at that speed. The best I can describe the transition is that the game slows itself down for you when you become a higher level player, even though it obviously doesn't do that. Pro players start on level 18, the first level that I just showed, or level 15 for some of the lower level competitions. Level 19 is mainly a practice speed, and after 130 lines at level 18, it'll transition to level 19. I'll explain why later. But first, before we talk about any of that, we need to go over basic terminology. The field where the pieces drop is called the matrix or the playfield. The community doesn't have a definitive term for this really, but in NES Tetris, it's 10 rows wide and 12 rows high. This can change in other games like Game Boy Tetris, but for NES Tetris and most other games, this is the standard. Each of these pieces that are falling is called a tetromino. They're connected groups of four blocks, and there are seven possible combinations of these four blocks, so they're all interconnected. These are all shown on the left on the statistics screen. This one is called the T, this one is called the J, this one is called the Z, this one is called the O, this one is called the S, this one is called the L, and this one is called the I. These red numbers beside each piece is how many times each piece has appeared in your game. So right now there's a T on the board, so 1 is on the T counter, because there's one T in the board. So I'll unpause this and drop this T. You can see the next piece was a J in this next box. So there now, there's one T and one J in the board as shown on the statistics screen. This is your next box. Learning how to use this is one of the key parts to playing fast, and I'll explain why later. This is your A-type or B-type display. This will show whether you're playing A-type or B-type. It doesn't really matter for our purposes. This is your line counter, self-explanatory. This shows how many lines you cleared. This is the top score that you've had during the session that you have your console powered on. This resets every time you power your console off since the cartridge does not have a battery in it. And this is your current score. I'll explain the score system later. This is your level counter. That's also self-explanatory. You may notice that during level 0, the pieces are mostly blue and have a bluish theme. This will change for every level. I'll show you. For level 1, the pieces have a greenish theme. For level 2, the pieces have a pinkish purplish theme. For level 3, the pieces have a green blue theme. For level 4, the pieces have a magenta and light green theme. For level 5, the pieces have a light green, light blue theme. For level 6, the pieces have a red and gray theme. For level 7, the pieces have a purple and dark red theme. For level 8, the pieces have a blue and red theme. For level 9, the pieces have an orange and red theme. And this cycle will repeat every 10 levels. So we're on level 10 right now, and it has the exact same colors as level 0. So now you see level 0, here's level 10. It repeats every 10 levels. Now, I'll explain the score system. What better tool to use to help than the manual for the game? As you can see, a single on level 0 gives 40 points, a double gives 100, a triple gives 300, and a Tetris gives 1200. These represent clearing 1, 2, 3, or 4 lines at once respectively. To calculate it for other levels, we need to add 1 onto the level number, so level 0 becomes level 1, level 19 becomes level 20, and then multiply that number by these base values. For example, with this logic, a single at level 19 will give you 800 points. 1 plus 19 is 20, and 20 times 40 is 800. Also, due to the way that the table works, if you want to get a high score, you need to go for Tetrises, or 4 line clears at once. The way that you get these is by filling up every block of 4 rows except for 1 block, and allowing you to cleanly put an eyepiece in. This is also called the long bar, and this piece will clear 4 lines and make your screen flash, along with playing a special sound effect different from the normal line clear sound effect. You saw that in the game I played earlier, and that's it for the score. Now I'll explain something else, the level counter. So under normal use, the level counter will go to the next level after 10 lines. But if you start at, say, level 9, the game will go to level 10 after 100 lines, which is the exact same as level 0. Okay, simple enough. But if you start in level 10 and get 100 lines, the game will advance to level 11 earlier. The same is true if you start on level 11, 12, 13, 14, or 15. It will advance to the next level after 100 lines. But if you start at level 16, it goes to the next after 110 lines, on level 17, 120 lines, and on level 18, 130 lines, like I said earlier. This number is very important to remember if you intend to play level 18, and I'll tell you why when I talk about game strategy. This odd counting mechanism is caused by a bug in the game, but this counting mechanism just so happens to be a key part of its difficulty. Like I said, I'll explain why later. So now that I've covered all the basics and everything that you should know going into the game, let's play! I really should have gone over this earlier, but to move the pieces left or right after starting a game, use the left and right buttons. So rotate the piece 90 degrees clockwise. If I can get a piece that will actually show it, here, use the A button. To rotate it counterclockwise, use the B button. To make a piece that's currently active fall faster, you hold the down arrow. Like so. So that's one of the many spins that I'm going to be showing you later. The tried and true method of placing pieces is to fill the first 9 columns with blocks and keep the 10th row of the playfield empty to put an eyepiece in and get a Tetris, which will get you the most score for lines cleared. This is the fundamental principle that top players use to play as well as they do. However, there are a few more things you need to know to do this properly, like the pros. But first, another word about that line counter. You might ask, well, if it just gets really, really fast in the end, then why can't you just clear singles the whole time if it's still playable the whole time? Well, here's the thing, it isn't. At level 29, or 230 lines if you start from level 18, or anything like level 15, or higher than that, that's the kill screen of NES Tetris. At that speed, it's impossible to move the pieces left and right if you're just using the auto shifter, and even people who can hyper-tap the controller, I'll explain what that is later, can only survive for so long. Now that you know that, let's get on to how to score. So, here, using your next box. The way the pros place their pieces so quickly is by using the next box. The next box shows the piece that's coming up, and while pros are waiting for their current piece to fall, they're thinking about where they're going to place the next piece. For example, I can move this Z piece to a position, and while the Z piece is falling, I'm thinking about what's in the next box. So I'm like, okay, where am I going to place this I piece? And as you can see, the Z piece will fall here, so in my mind, I'm envisioning where I put this here, so I'm going to put this I down here and tuck it underneath that piece. So I'm going to put this Z piece here. And now, what am I going to do with this piece? Well, I'm going to put it right here. And you get the idea. So while I was pushing that piece down, I was thinking about where I wanted to put this T that's falling right now, and I want to put it here. And I want to put this J here, so I'll do that when that locks. You get the idea. And that's also a nice example of right willing. You want to keep the first, fill the first 9 columns 4 rows high, and let this long bar drop in. And when it locks, 4 lines will be cleared and the special sound will play and the screen will flash. If you saw that, that added 1200 points to our score. And that's the basic principle behind playing fast in NES Tetris. However, there are many other things that the pros use, and I'm going to show you some of those techniques. Things that the pros You can use the next box to avoid dependencies. A dependency is depending on a piece to survive. To avoid dependencies, you must make optimal placements that are both accommodating to your next piece and help your stack in a middle ground between being too flat and too jagged. When your stack is flat, you won't be able to have an accommodating spot for less flat pieces like Z pieces and S pieces. When your stack is too jagged, you won't have an accommodating spot for flatter pieces like J's and L's. When you place your pieces, you must keep this in mind. The best way to learn how to do this is from other people, like Jonas Neubauer. Sometimes, you'll find yourself in a situation where you're stacking too high and you're getting close to death at the top of the screen. I'll try to get into one of those situations right now. So something like this on level 18 would be something where you need to start burning. So what is burning? Burning is clearing any piece that's not an eye and clearing less than 4 lines with it. So for example, to avoid death, I might need to put this piece here to clear this line, and I might need to put this piece here in order to set up a spot for something else to go here and clear these 2 lines. I have 2 O pieces, so that's perfect. I put this one here, I put the next one over there, drop them both, and if I rotate this eye and put it here, I burn with it, and that opens up my well again, so now I'm free to put an eye in there. And I have a Tetris set up, so in a normal game, this would be very nice. And the level just advanced. You heard the special level up sound, and the colors changed. Odds are, the majority of you aren't good enough to tap more than 10 times a second on your input device of choice. Well, if you can't do that, I'll show you how to use the built-in DAS or late auto shifter that comes with the game. The basic principle behind the auto shifter is that it taps every six frames after an initial delay of 16 frames. That's 10 times a second after it charges itself up, with a delay of 266 milliseconds, or a little bit more than a quarter of a second. Right now I'm running this emulator at 25% speed to help show this to you. So you can see when I press a directional button, for 16 frames, it will start charging up. And then after those 16 frames, it will reset itself back to 10, and then start counting up again, and every time when it reaches 16, it will tap once. This counter is reset when you hit a directional button, most of the time. Under certain circumstances, it is not. I'll talk about those in a few minutes. So here's the fundamentals, now that you have a basic grasp of how the auto shifter works. The auto shifter uses a 16 frame counter, the one shown up here. This would normally not be visible in normal gameplay. When you press a directional button, the counter will reset to 0, with a few exceptions, and it'll start counting up. When you move the piece, when it moves the piece one space in whatever direction you're holding, it will move back to 10, and start counting up again, and move the piece like I just told you. And here's something else. If we get this piece to fall, there's a small spawn delay before the next piece spawns. So we can use that because the dash cannot be manipulated whatever you do during that spawn delay. If you saw, when I was holding the directional button, the dash charged itself to 16. That's the result of a wall charge. I'll explain that momentarily. But we started with a dash charge. Normally, if I held the directional button, after the piece came onto the field, the dash would reset itself to 0. But since we are in the ARE period, it did not do that when we pressed the button, since the dash counter cannot be manipulated during the ARE period. So this allows you to redirect your dash charge. What redirecting it means is that if we are just pressing right on that piece, we can let this piece fall, and then during that ARE period, we can hit that button and it will start shifting immediately in the opposite direction, which is something that under normal circumstances, it would not do. So now I'll show you wall charges. If the dash taps against the wall or the stack, or if you tap against the wall or a stack, if anything taps against a wall or the stack, then the counter will automatically charge itself up to 16 no matter what it was at before. This is presumably to make tucking easier, but it can be abused to instantly charge the desk. So I'm going to hit left momentarily. You can see that the desk counter just charged itself up right up to 16. Since I missed the initial spawn delay there, since I missed the ARE period, the dash charge did not carry over to the next piece, but if I had not missed it, it would have. These principles are going to be the basis that every dash player will have to found their playstyle on. If you do not know these principles, you will not be able to play NES Tetris at a high level if you're not able to tap. So here are a few other things you can do. This is easier to show in 25% speed. You have a 6-frame window every time the piece is in position, the position that you want it. So let's say I want to put this Z right here. You have a 6-frame window once the piece is in that position to release the directional button. So it's easier to show like this. So you can release it within that 6-frame position to keep whatever dash charge that you have, and the piece will still fall into this position. And during the ARE, you can redirect this dash charge. So for example, this next piece, I'm going to move this to the right once this piece locks. And as you can see, it started moving to the right, even though we didn't go up against the wall to wall charge the piece because of skill stopping. Same thing here. Line cleared. So here's another use for wall charges. So let's say I want to move the piece to this position, but I move it one too far. Even though I never want to do that, but I want to move it here. I move it one too far by mistake. I have to tap back, and I lose my dash charge. However, I can use the wall charge technique, because there is a wall here that this piece can go on. I missed it there, but like this. Once this piece goes into the position, I can hit the directional button and move the piece over with the dash immediately. So here's another semi-advanced technique. You can hold your directional key, and while you're still holding it, hold your down button and release that. So only the down button is held. And then hold the target directional key that you want to go to, and then release the down button, and you will keep your dash charge. That is the last resort method and is called Red Fireball, and that term was coined by Alex Kerr, a Tetris Grandmaster. This is just a small quirk in the auto shifter, and no one really knows why that is there. So that's the basic principles of dash charging and what you'll need to found your playstyle on. Now I'll talk about hyper tapping. You may have heard the term hyper tapping before, but you may not be sure entirely what it is. While hypertapping is tapping the controller more than 10 times a second and effectively bypassing the internal DAS. So this allows you to play with a higher stack and take risks that players who only use the DAS would not be able to take without dying. So this is moving the piece with DAS. You can see the initial delay. And then it'll move 10 times a second. But with tapping, that's normal tapping. This is not hyper tapping. That's hyper tapping. Tapping a piece faster than the built-in DAS and effectively bypassing it, this will allow you to play with a higher stack at a higher level. So just how useful would this be? Well, here's me playing 19 with DAS. I can't play very high compared to my 19 tapping game. See? Fail missed drop there. Now I'll show you one of my older videos. In this video, I'm playing a level 19 start. If you see how high I'm stacking, and I managed to get out of this in the end, even though the game itself was not meant to be. So that just shows you how useful hypertapping is. However, one thing about hypertapping, every person will be different. There's no definitive way to do it, and you have to find what works for you. You can take a look at some other people's scripts, like Corian and Joseph, the two most popular hypertappers, and you can take a look at their grips and find inspiration for your grip from theirs. However, it varies from person to person, and nobody is born a hypertapper. Even if you can't do it right now with your grip of choice, it'll require a ton of practice. After that practice, you'll be able to do it fairly consistently, and with a bit more practice, you'll be able to do it consistently, most of the time. Now I'm going to show you a few spins that you might find useful to keep your stack clean. So first is the S spin. When I get an S piece, I'm going to show it to you. Here we go. So if you find yourself in this kind of a situation, you can simply tap, and the S piece will rotate into this gap. This spin is very, very useful to get out of some sticky situations where you don't have a J piece handy. Now I'll show you the Z spin. When the Z comes up, right now, when you see this kind of a gap, you can either tuck a T piece in, or if you're feeling risky, you can spin a Z piece in, like so. I just hit one of the rotate buttons and it just spun into place. That's also a very useful and very versatile spin. Now I'll show you one of the many variations of the T-spin. This is a very common technique in modern Tetris games, but it exists in almost every Tetris game out there. This is the T-spin. So you can hit the B button here to rotate it left, and that will make the T reach normally that gap that the T just rotated into would be unreachable by any other piece. So that's why the T-spin is so special. It allows you to fill these holes. So now I can show you the L-spin, if I can get an L. Here we go. In a gap like this, that's too tall, there are a few spins and tucks that you can do to fill this up. I'll show you some of those momentarily. But when the L is in this position, you can just rotate it clockwise, and that's that. You just cleared a line. Now I can show you the J spin. This one, for some reason, is less common. However, it works on basically the same principle as that other spin I just did. So you wait until the J reaches this position, and then you hit the B button, and it fills the same hole pretty much the same way. Now I'll show you a few other ways to fill up the gap. I've already shown you the L spin with that gap. What about this? I can do a Z spin here. And I can tuck this J underneath that. Here's another way to fill the gap. You can just tuck this piece in. like so. Now I'll show you some Game Genie codes. This list that I have over here on the right is the entire list of Game Genie codes from the Classic Tetris Monthly Discord. I'll post this in the description in a pastebin, or you can look at all of these now. So I'll show you how to add Game Genie codes in NES Tetris after loading the ROM. If you go to Options menu, you can select Cheats. I've already added this code here, which I'll demonstrate. This code makes every block that you put down onto the field seem like a Tetris to the game. You can enable code with this checkmark menu. And I'll start a game and show you what that code does. So yeah, that gets pretty boring after a while. Let's try something else. You can delete a code with the delete button. You can add a code with the add button. And this is how you add it. So previously, raw would be selected. You select the Game Genie menu. You type in your code. So why don't I try the invisible Tetris code? Or rather, this isn't a code, it's a series of codes. On real hardware, you can only enter in 3 codes. However, on emulator, you can enter in as many as you want. So I'll enter the other 2 codes that are necessary for this. And now all these codes are active. And I'll boot the game back up. And let's play some invisible Tetris. So as you can see, that makes the stack invisible. So there are some other more useful codes here. This one will keep the DAS always charged for you. This is more of a cheat. This one will change the DAS delay to 4 frames instead of 6. This is useful for getting used to if you plan to start hyperdapping, but you can't do it yet. This will help you get used to it. This code will turn off the DAS completely if you really want to practice hypertapping. This code will change the level every 10 lines no matter what level you start on. This code will keep you at the same level permanently, so like if you want to do just permanent level 18 or permanent level 19, that would be useful. This code will let you skip the rocket screen, this code will let you skip the copyright screen at the beginning, and this code will prevent you from maxing out by uncapping the score. Again, I have all these codes in the description. But ultimately, all the stuff that I've shown today is only meant to be the basics. You can learn more advanced techniques by watching someone like Jonas Neubauer. I highly recommend checking out his video, Tetris 101 with Jonas Neubauer, online. That video already has 200,000 or so views at this time of posting. And that video will show you much more in terms of advanced techniques than what I've covered here today. Like I've said, this video is not meant to be an advanced tutorial, it's meant to be a basic tutorial. However, everything covered here today should be enough for you to get a score at about like 200,000 or so. With that out of the way, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you enjoyed it, please consider leaving a like. If you didn't, you can dislike. That button works too. And if you want more great content, then you can subscribe. I don't really post these kinds of videos too often. I mostly just post gameplay highlights. If you have any questions or comments, leave them down below. But for now, enjoy your first few games, and happy stacking!